Welcome to another exciting special edition of the Grand Circle Tour podcast. This is Stan Solo, Captain Stan Solo, and I'm here with my three favorite Grand Circle Tour podcast co-hosts. It's kind of the round table Mandalorian group with Jason Gaughan and Dan pinch hitting. Let's start off with my regular buddy, Dan. How are you today?
Stan Solo, how are you?
I'm excited as always. We saw a new Star Wars movie this week.
You know, as I walked out of the movie, you're one of the first people I thought about, thinking, I wonder if Stan liked this movie. Share your opinion.
Well, who else are you going to think about?
There's a couple of crazy Star Wars fans in my my little circle. So.
Yeah, I would kind of imagine. Also joining me is one of the two Clarks. We've got Scott Clark. Scott, how are you today?
I'm doing great, Stan. Another great evening.
Right on. And Justin Clark. Justin, how are you today, my friend?
I'm doing fantastic. Glad to be here.
Right on. So as per usual, we're going to start off doing non-spoilers. We'll take a quick commercial break and we'll come back into spoilers. So if you haven't seen this movie yet, and judging by the box office, chances are you have. I think it's doing really well. You know what? Could someone, whoever is free, call up the Rotten Tomatoes thing? Because I want to talk about that for a little bit. The box office is doing phenomenal in this movie. Dan, you saw it this morning?
Yeah, I went this morning. It was I went with about 30 people. Well, maybe not 30, 20 people, I would say.
A group of 20?
A group of 20 people. We bought tickets the first day they went on sale. It was actually one of my son's friend dads who organized it. And
okay.
A bunch of families went. So we had a nice little group. And it almost like added to the fun of everything, you know.
Yeah, so it had to have been sold out then if you guys bought half the theater.
Well, I think we had maybe like three rows. That's it. That's all it was.
Okay.
So, yeah. But then we did bring our kids, so you know, and we went at 10 o'clock in the morning. So I think the group that we were with were a little bit of a younger audience.
Okay, how was the audience? Were they into it? Were they hooting, hollering? Were they? What was it like?
The adults were in mine, you know.
Okay.
Most of the children were just sitting there.
Okay.
Taking
it. And Justin, how was your theater experience for this one?
It was good.
When did you go first of all?
What's that?
When did you go first of all?
When did I go? We went Friday night after work. Okay. So it was a pretty packed theater. We had also bought our tickets way back when they first were made available.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, so it was pretty packed theater.
Was it a quiet crowd? What was it? Hollering? Anyone dressed up?
This is North Dakota. We didn't have too many people dressed up out here. And it was mostly a quiet group. There was a few shouts here and there, like when the Star Wars logo first came up and things like that. But nothing too major.
Alrighty. And how about you, Scott?
Went and seen it on Thursday night, the 6 o'clock show. It's pretty packed, pretty live crowd, a lot of hooting and hollering going on throughout the movie. So,
okay. Was anyone dressed up or anything like that? Or
there was a handful of people that dressed up.
Okay, like Jedi, or what did they have?
We had a guy in a beard dress up like Rey.
So a guy in a beard dressed up like Rey.
Yeah.
Awesome.
Jedi and Kylo Ren, and a couple Rays.
The crowd I was with, I went opening night 10 o'clock, and then I went again 10 o'clock the next morning, Friday morning, and both times the crowd was really quiet. They're both sold out. Both theaters are sold out. Very quiet crowd, like not a peep the entire time. And I think I was the only one in a Star Wars shirt. I had one of my shirts that I made. I didn't see one other person with a – I had my Star Wars mitts, my toque, my shirt, and not one other – person. The guy I went with just wore a black shirt. It was like, this is a Star Wars crowd?
I even wore my Stormtrooper socks.
Yeah. I didn't see anybody with anything. It was very, very weird. And it's super quiet. And usually I yell, woo, during the Lucasfilm when that first comes up. And even I didn't say anything, which is unusual. Scott, did you call up the Rotten Tomatoes?
Yeah, Rotten Tomatoes came in at 58.
And that's for the critic.
Yep, 58 for Rotten Tomatoes. And the fan audience, it came in at 85 or 80. I think it's 86 for the fan.
So it went up 1% since I checked it last, because I checked it earlier and it was 86 and it was 50. I think it was 58 for the critics before too. So I think the fans are liking this. Most people I talk to have enjoyed it. Very few I've talked to that a lot of people just saying it was okay. A lot of people really enjoyed it. But we'll find out what we thought about it. I think the John Williams score was phenomenal in this one.
As always.
Yeah. I felt he really outdid himself. You could really hear the themes for all the different characters on par. Like they were John Williams, he's the oxygen of Star Wars. What else do we go into with non spoiler? What did you guys do? Do we want to do rating? I can't even rate this one, honestly.
You can't rate it? What do you mean?
I don't know. You know what? It's not my favorite Star Wars movie by any stretch of the imagination, but it's definitely not my worst. Where do you guys put it there, Dan?
I really enjoyed it, and I was pleasantly surprised that I really enjoyed it. Mm-hmm. You know what it is? I think that I wasn't expecting too much after The Last Jedi, and you know, I really, you know, I know a lot of it was put in there to satisfy the fans. I get it, but guess what? I am a fan, so I was satisfied. You know?
That sums it up pretty much.
Right.
You guys agree with Dan?
Yeah, I definitely enjoyed this a lot more than The Last Jedi. I thought there was definitely a step up from there. I would say it's definitely in up there for one of my favorite Star Wars movies.
Oh, wow. Okay.
I agree with that.
I liked the way it seemed to kind of try to wrap up a bunch of things.
Yeah, it does wrap up nicely. It really does. What about you, Scott? Same type of scenario?
Yeah, I really enjoyed it. I would say it's probably in my top three or four of all Star Wars movies. I definitely liked it a lot more than The Last Jedi. So, yes, it is a fan movie. And, you know, I'm a Star Wars fan, and I enjoyed it. This is what I came in. Going into it, my expectations, I didn't know what to think. Because after seeing Last Jedi, it just kind of left a bad taste in my mouth. I enjoyed it and I did it. So, but when I came into this, yeah, I was really pleasantly surprised in how I came out feeling about this movie. So I really enjoyed it.
Yeah. I think all four of us are in the same situation then where I think you guys put a little bit higher than I do on the list of Star Wars films, but I felt the same way. I thought, yes, there was fan service, but I'm a fan. That's what I wanted to see. And that's what I didn't like about The Last Jedi. It was that it was too much out there. I felt like it just rubbed me the wrong way. The whole movie didn't make sense to me, The Last Jedi. And this one I enjoyed. I had a great time the whole time in this one. I think that's about it for non-spoilers. We're going to take a quick break. Yeah. So if you haven't seen the movie yet, we're going to take a quick break. And when we come back, pause us now, go see the movie, run, don't walk, run to see the movie, come back, hit play and listen to the rest of the show. Okay, we'll be back right after this.
Star Wars. You and your children loved it. Now the Earthlings at Kenner have asked my associate and me to present the Star Wars collection. Truly remarkable toys and games for your children. What are you so excited about now? My goodness, the Star Wars TIE Fighter and X-Wing Fighter. Now your children can relive our great space battles or collect our wonderful Star Wars companions with Kenner's Star Wars action figures. R2, it's a little new. Kenner's new radio-controlled R2-D2 anyone can command. Ah, the Star Wars land speeder that moves like it's floating. And here's Kenner's Death Star Space Station, four floors of action, a trash compactor too. Yes, R2, that's the Star Wars electronic laser battle, a game of speed, reflex, and reaction. These and other toys and games in Kenner's Star Wars collection are sold separately. Batteries are not included. May the Force be with you and your children.
And we're back. All right, that was great. Thank you, Jason. That was awesome. I appreciated that what you put in there. It's always neat when you do something like that. The opening crawl in this, we're going right into spoilers. The opening crawl, I felt, was a lot of information in there. I think more than the usual opening crawls have. Like, they were kind of talking about the Palpatine's back already. They tell you that right off the hop, Palpatine's back. They're hearing transmissions from the dead. Kylo Ren is looking for him. He's hunting him. He's going to kill him as soon as he finds him. I mean, that didn't last very long once you found him. He kind of chickened out right away. But it goes right into Kylo Ren. Like, who were those guys he was fighting at the beginning there in the woods? He had some troopers with him. They all died, too. He was the only one left standing.
You know what? I heard who they were. I can't remember right now. I'm going to look it up right now. Hold on. You guys keep talking. I'm going to tell you.
I'm thinking of these. They weren't the Emperor's guards. They weren't dressed in red. It looked like they were locals to that planet that he was in with the woods.
From what I see here in my notes, Mustafar
is
where they were.
Which is where, there's a temple or something on Mustafar? I don't know. I heard this last week going into it. I'm gonna look it up.
Wasn't Mustafar where, what was the planet where Anakin got beat by?
That was where the droid base was at, where they all got in. And, right. Anakin killed all the droids, their bosses.
Okay.
You know, I thought Mustafar, wasn't Mustafar like Darth Vader's, where his
castle home was?
Exactly.
Yeah, that's what it was.
Yeah, that's okay.
Vader's. Yep.
So I was confused right off the bat.
I'm looking at the note here, and it has been confirmed that it is Mustafar.
Okay. Yeah, so I don't know. I was confused right off the hop. So I don't want to go scene by scene like we do with the round table, because I don't have that good of a memory. But then we cut to Finn, Poe, Chewie, and some random alien we never seen before. I missed the name. Looking for a spy. They're going to get some information from the spy. Very Rogue One feeling, I felt, with that big 8-track cassette that they plugged into R2-D2. With the wire coming out of it. Yeah, not even, they don't even have Bluetooth.
Yeah, the technology in Star Wars is always confusing to me. Just
they don't have Bluetooth. That's a good line.
Yeah, no, they have to run the wire from this thing from one ship to another ship. It was just kind of interesting.
Yeah, they can send holograms from one point in the universe to another, but they can't send a little message without a giant cable from one ship to another.
Yeah, exactly. I thought that was kind of like, okay, that's how Star Wars is. And
I did like, though, once they got that information from the spy, when all those TIE fighters were coming in and how they escaped and did all those light speed jump, or the light speed jumps. I enjoyed that.
Yeah, that was cool. And even like he says, how thick you think that ice is? And Chewie looks at him and roars something, and didn't even give him a chance to, you know, try to bust through it. I don't know if that ice was thick, they might have been in trouble. that was a great opening. Then they cut to Rey training with all the rocks spinning around. And what planet are they on? It's the jungle planet of
somewhere. It was one of the planets of Endor. Wait, no, it wasn't. No,
Endor is later.
Endor was later.
Yeah.
Imagine Kloss.
Yeah. So we find out that Leia is training Rey now. Like, whatever happened to, like, Luke was too old, and he didn't want to, Ben didn't want to train him, or Luke Han, what you call it, didn't want to chain him. all that stuff. So, but yet Leia can train Rey, no questions asked. I mean, maybe they talked backstage, you know, off camera that Rey was the right age. I don't know. They're not following the rules of Star Wars in that type of thing. But they have no choice. Who else are you going to have? She's the only one with the Force.
Yeah,
you
don't want her to go to the dark side at the moment.
Well, yeah. I think you find out a little bit later on in the movie, Leia was capable of training Rey when brought it up to Ray.
And since we're talking about Leia here, I just want to mention they did a pretty good job of having Leia in the movie, considering that Carrie Fisher has passed away. So using, as I understand it, they were using like some deleted scenes and such from The Last Jedi that they had recorded before. So that's why she has so few lines, is because they just had a few lines to work with and kind of wrote a lot of dialogue and whatnot around it. But I still felt like they did a good job with it.
Yeah, I agree. You know, I had a friend who went Friday night, and he told me, or Thursday night, and he told me on Friday that he thought there was like a little, like she looked smaller in the film. So I was like looking for that, but I didn't notice any of that. I thought they did a really good job with it.
Yeah, I think they did a phenomenal job. I'm not sure if those scenes that she did were in front of a green screen or if they were able to put a green screen behind her and cut her in. I mean, it's photoshopped, her being there. I don't think that was filmed on location with Carrie Fisher. I think that the scenes with her were filmed
for other things, right, and right. She was kind of cut out of those backgrounds and put into these new backgrounds. But
yeah, like it's pretty amazing that they can do that.
Absolutely.
Yeah. I thought that J.J. Abrams, he had a lot of things to battle to get this movie out.
Yeah.
I mean, sure Ryan did. Johnson destroyed a lot of things for J.J.
Yeah, there was a bit of retconning going on here, I felt, at times.
I thought there was a little bit of slap in his face a little bit, especially with the lightsaber part where... Did you guys catch that? Where he said, when Luke caught the lightsaber, and he goes, you have to handle these with care, these weapons. I thought that was a complete like knock of Last Jedi when he just threw the lightsaber.
Yeah.
You know what I'm talking about?
I see what you're saying.
I would love to hear the real story. Like when JJ had Rey hand Luke the lightsaber in The Last Jedi, and then Luke throws it over his shoulder.
Right.
What did JJ want Luke to do with it if it wasn't to throw it over his shoulder? Like, because he ended it with like Ryan Johnson going, well, what am I supposed to do with this thing? I don't know. I'll throw it over his shoulder. Like, you know what I mean? Like I'd like to get the story behind what did JJ want versus what Ryan did, or did Ryan do what JJ wanted with the lightsaber? I don't know if we're ever going to get the final story, but I mean like Ryan Johnson killed off Snoke, so now JJ goes, well, wait a minute here, what do, I don't know, bring Palpatine back, I have nothing else. Like, like what is he supposed to do, you know? He goes, well, he got rid of my villain, like that was going to be Rey's granddaughter or grandfather, but I can't use that now, you know. So I'm just guessing, you know. Yeah. that was what JJ had envisioned. I really wish JJ just had the entire trilogy.
Yeah, I agree.
I think the entire trilogy would have been made more sense.
Yep.
Or if anything, he had creative input on it since he started the first act, at least had some input going into the second act to the third act.
Well, and then like Ryan destroyed JJ's mask, or not, sorry, Kylo's mask. So JJ's like, well, we'll just fix it. We'll get a guy from Planet of the Apes to come and he'll fix the mask. I really felt like as if these two directors are kind of like pissing off each other almost. Did you get that feeling?
Yeah, like there was definitely a battle of the wills going on between those two.
You know, I think ultimately that's what really stinks about this whole last trilogy, is that it wasn't, at least we all think that it wasn't planned from start to finish. You know, they kind of like just went with the flow, and that's why we have so many questions, I think.
Yeah, and I think it was almost like, well, we'll get the fan reaction and then we'll write for that, is what it almost feels like. Well, the fans didn't like the mask, let's destroy the mask.
Yep.
And then JJ comes in and goes, well, you know what, I like the mask, I'm bringing it back. It almost feels like that. So,
do you guys think the original plan when they first made the character of Rey was to have her have some lineage to some bad guy, whether it's Palpatine or someone?
I don't think it was Palpatine. I think Palpatine was brought on because Snoke was gone. I think Snoke was going to be the lineage to Rey.
Yeah, you think that's what it was?
That's what I think. And I think JJ went, well, I'll have to come up with something else now.
Right.
And it was like, well, McDermott's
going around. I agree that it wasn't Palpatine, because if it was Palpatine, they should have given us some kind of like clue in the last movie, right? Like, you got to set it up somehow.
Yeah.
So I agree that it wasn't Palpatine. I just wonder if it was maybe another character that she had lineage, and maybe it is Snoke.
Yeah, yeah. Maybe I guess we'll never know. You know, it's unfortunate.
Unless
we get to go for coffee with them or something.
Yeah, I agree. I think she was supposed to have some type of lineage on J.J. Abrams' side from The Force Awakens going into the Last Jedi into this movie. You know, whether it was some previous either Jedi or Sith. But like I said, I don't think now you'll never know. Now it's Palpatine.
Yeah, very fact that they made her parentage such a mystery in the first movie meant that they always intended to pay it off in the third in some way, most likely.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. And yeah, I agree completely. So what is it? What happens that they're going somewhere? What everything happens so quick in this movie, I can't keep track. So they're going off to this desert, and it is a party that happens every 42 years.
Which is a great Easter egg right there, right? Did everyone get that one?
No, I didn't catch that. What was that?
What happened?
That's 42 years since the first movie.
Oh, that went right over my head.
That was a great Easter egg.
I didn't catch that at all. Okay.
So like, this happens once every 42 years. I'm like, nice, nice.
I didn't get it either, Stan, so don't feel
too bad. I'm wondering, and I even thought 42 years has got to mean something. Because I'm thinking, like, what's the purpose of this? Yeah. Okay. I like that he says, Chewie, keep your head down.
Yeah, and he just ducks a little bit. He like crouches.
He's like, what am I supposed to do? I'm a Wookiee.
Well, go on all fours, Chewie. You're a dog now.
Yeah, so they are looking for where Luke had stopped looking for the Wayfinder to find the planet Exegol or whatever, where the Sith are supposed to be hanging out, where they think Palpatine's going to be.
Exactly. So that's what they're trying to find, is the Wayfinder, right?
The Wayfinder, yes.
Wayfinder. So they don't find the Wayfinder, but they, you know what, and they had that chase scene with those flying troopers. I'm not sure if you saw the behind the scenes shots at all. You don't see it on the film at all. But those troopers that could fly.
Yeah.
The jetpacks.
Their armor has fins on it. I was watching really close on the film. I can't see it. Yeah, on the back of their calf and on their forearms, they have fins to help them fly.
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah, I thought it was really cool. I didn't see it on the film.
Some of the battle scenes and some of the scenes, especially in this section of the film, I thought looked very much like a Michael Bay film. Particularly, they had one scene where people were standing up on the cliff face or whatever, and the drone shot goes all the way around them. And I'm like, that is a classic Michael Bay shot. What are you guys doing with doing that kind of thing in a Star Wars film?
The design of I'm going to call them sandmobiles, because they like snowmobiles, but without skis. They just have a big track. I thought those things were really cool. I want to drive those around.
Yeah. I said the same thing to my buddy sitting next to me.
You want
to
drive those?
I whispered to him, like, I want one of these.
yeah. I mean, they got a corner like crap. Like, there's no way you could turn well with that, the straight track. I mean, all Ray had to do was make a U-turn, and she's gone. Those guys, are, you know, there was no.
They actually call it a tread speeder.
That's the name of speeder.
Tread speeder. Yeah, makes sense.
Yeah, that's a good name. Sure. Yeah, I thought those were really cool. So we get to meet Billy Dee Williams. The legendary Billy Dee Williams finds him, and because Chewie's so easy to find. Now, was anyone surprised when he was originally masked? And you immediately, that was Billy Dee. Did you guys catch it right away?
As soon as I saw the mask, I was like, oh, here we go. Here's where he's coming in. Because I knew he was going to be in the film.
Yeah, yeah. And he had the same build. You know, he's kind of a heavier, well, not as heavy as I am, but he's a heavier guy now than he used to be. It was great to see great to see Billy Dee in the grand, and again. And again, if this is the fan service that people are complaining about, bring it on. I love that Billy Dee was in this movie. You guys?
Yeah, it was good to see him again. I agree with you on that.
Yeah.
Yep,
it was great.
So they go in the quicksand, which was kind of weird that the entire planet was in quicksand. It's actually the, you know, the Star Wars. Yeah, like one planet's all water, another planet's all desert, another planet's all snow. How come this planet wasn't all quicksand? But there was a little area with quicksand. So or whatever that was that they're going in, quick rocks, I don't know. I thought that was kind of unnecessary, but I guess they had to do something that, because Luke never found the compass. So they had to do something to explain why Luke couldn't find it.
But these people could.
Yeah.
You know what it reminded me of? It reminded me of Goonies.
Yeah.
That's exactly it. That too.
Yeah, right?
Yep. Yeah, now that you say it, absolutely.
So, I actually thought more of the Harry Potter film. I thought of the Harry Potter film where they were going through the...
Yeah, that too. The plants. But you know what else reminded me of Goonies? You know the part where they finally get the sword and the little piece pops out?
Mm-hmm.
And they're measuring against the Death Star.
Yeah.
In the Goonies ads when they're looking for
that,
the rocks.
That was Goonies through and through.
Okay, so does that make sense to anybody that worked?
No.
like she happened to be standing in the exact right spot to line it up to get to point to exactly where the wayfinder was.
Well, it worked in Goonies, so why wouldn't it work here?
I mean, like, okay, so.
Well, and on a planet with that much water activity, things would shift over time.
Well, no, because I guess the entire Death Star would shift with it. Yeah. It was still in the Death Star.
Some of it would rot, of course.
Yeah, but I don't know. It just did not make sense to me at all. Like in Raiders of the Lost Ark, when Indy gets the staff and he knows how long to make the staff. And he knows what hole to put it in because of the day. And then the sun hits at a certain time and it shows exactly where the arc is. It all makes sense because the staff has to be a certain height. You have to follow which day of the week it was or day of the year it was. And you have to put it in the proper hole at the proper time in order to get the light, a beam of light to go through the Idol of Ra or whatever it was.
Mm-hmm.
Ray just randomly goes there and whatever and just holds it up. I don't know. Well, I think it would have made more sense if it.
That's
if it
how the force comes. Works.
Yeah, yeah. That's not how the force works. It would have made more sense if the blade went somewhere and then she lined it up. You know what I mean? Like she just let go of it and it went on its own or something. I don't know. It didn't make sense to me. I didn't understand it. So, anyways, I'm going ahead. So how did they end up? Why did they end up on that planet where Carrie Russell was? Where does that come in?
Oh, because C-3PO,
right? They need the knife.
Could read the dagger, but then he couldn't tell them what it said.
He couldn't tell it,
yeah. Okay, I'm missing a big point. Chewbacca's death. Okay, for those of you who haven't seen it, this is a spoiler. Chewbacca dies.
You know, if you're going to say spoiler warning, you're supposed to say that before you do the spoiler.
I gave a spoiler after the commercial break.
Yeah, we already gave a spoiler warning.
I gave a spoiler warning after the commercial break. Okay, so Chewbacca's death. I wanted to talk about that for a little bit. Did this make sense to anybody? Like, Justin, you, before we came on, you were talking about you made a really good point about it.
Oh, did I? Which point was that? No, I think what I was saying is that the fact that they revealed to the audience right away that Chewie was actually still alive lessened that impact of it. It would have made much more sense from a narrative point of view even to keep the audience in the dark as long as they were keeping Rey and Poe and the others in the dark that Chewie was alive. So then when she realizes that he's alive and needs to go save him, we would feel that triumph right along with her.
Yeah. Yeah. That little clip that they showed where Chewie was captured and they were putting him in that cell and they took away his one piece of clothing and his, his bowcaster, that kind of ruined that. I agree with you completely. The other thing too is rather than, and I guess Chewie dying was just to get the fans to go, oh, that's that. You know, I think that was...
Well, I think the other part of it, too, was to show Rey inadvertently killing him.
Yeah.
And in a way that shows that she has a lot more of the dark side of the Force in her than she wants to accept.
I agree. I think that's what they were going for. I think that... Okay. But they didn't want the fans to freak out and say, why'd you make us feel like Chewie was dead the whole movie? So that's why they quickly told us, you know, showed the fans at least that he was alive.
I think
I'm not saying I liked it.
I like Justin's idea better. Okay, so that throws up my thought. Because my thought process, what should have happened was when they were both tug of warring on that ship, was that Kylo should have made a move that would either knock out Rey or distract Rey enough that she would lose concentration, allowing the ship to take off. So then now Chewie's captured rather than we all thinking he's dead.
Yep.
And then later on in the movie when they're battling, he tries that same move and she learns from it. And I think that would have shown character development on Rey's part within the movie, like that, in that she's learning from the mistakes every battle she does. I think that would have been another way to go about it. I think the way they did it was just bad.
Maybe I'm missing that part, but how did he try it again later on?
I'm saying, had he done that? Had he done something to distract her? Like, say he picked up a boulder and swung it, shot it at her.
Gotcha.
And he either hit her, knocked her out, and Poe picks her up and carries her to the ship, or she avoids it and runs to the ship, and you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Something along that line, and then she learns from that, and then later on, he tries that same move, but she's ready for it. I think would have shown character growth for Rey. But I guess she also got character growth in that she thought that, geez, I'm evil. I killed
Chewie. Yeah, because, you know, eventually when her and Kylo are going at it, and she basically gives up, right? I mean, that's what she does. I think if you didn't have those scenes with, like, you know, that she's capable of at least killing someone she loves, you know, that's one of the reasons why she's giving up, because she feels like I could cause a lot of harm as well.
Yeah.
I agree with you, Dan. I think that right there, it realized she has this power to do everything, you know, destroyed the ship essentially, and realized she can get turned to the dark side.
Yeah.
And she needs to better control her anger or feelings.
Yep. And she's got this vision too, you know, that's in the back of her head that, you know, she thinks eventually she's going to end up on that throne with Kylo.
Yeah. And then she also had that vision in The Last Jedi as well.
Yeah, that's what I mean. Yep.
Yeah, so she keeps getting these dark image visions of herself. So I guess it's her lineage. I don't know. So we go to this planet because C-3PO refuses to give them information because it's in his programming, blah, blah, whatever. I don't know. Why couldn't they just reprogram C-3PO rather than making him erase his memory, just reprogram his...
Well, and again, they erase his memory and then almost immediately they get it back so quickly. Why was that such a big thing then if they could just get his memory back?
Did they explain it? I was so confused with that part. I really left.
Well, even when they're talking about how they're going to have to wipe out his memory, they say, I think Rey mentions... Well, doesn't R2 have a backup of your memory?
Exactly.
Well, no, that's unreliable.
Okay.
Yet it worked fine because it's R2, and R2 is not unreliable, as we all know from having watched all the other movies.
I love Finn's line, though, when he's like, they're like, well, that's the only way we can do it. And Finn's like, okay, then that's what we'll do.
doesn't even think twice about it. Who cares about C-3PO? It's a droid, whatever. And how come he only had the red eyes just for a little bit? And then did he get reprogrammed again after that?
I think the red eyes was like when he's reciting what the Sith thing had said.
The Sith lines. That's what.
And then as soon as he was done with that, he basically kind of rebooted back to his normal self, just without memory.
Wiped his mind cleaned. There was memory. Okay.
So with that, so they sent him back to the factory settings.
Yep.
Now, when C-3PO was in Episode 1, he could barely walk. And I found out from somewhere that droids actually take a while to learn how to walk and to move. Like they're shaky when they first come out of programming. Yes. He wasn't shaky at all. He was able to walk right away and communicate perfectly fine. I am C-3PO. Who are you? You know, he just a side note. But in episode one, he was just like brand new and he was very shaky when he walked, and he was back to factory settings and he could walk.
Yeah, that being said, Stan, he's got his memory wiped before at the end of episode three.
Yeah, but we didn't see that though.
Yeah, there must be different levels of memory wiping because, because otherwise that doesn't make sense with what we see elsewhere. As you say.
Yeah. So where do they go after that?
Oh, let's see.
Is that where they go to? They find out that... No, they don't find out. How do they find out about Chewie? That he was captured as opposed to... Was it once they got there?
I think it was once they got to the ship, yeah. Then Rey could sense him.
That's what it was, yes. Okay, so they got to the ship. They shoot these stormtroopers in the landing bay. Why leave them there? Take a couple of seconds and drag them into the ship. I mean, I don't get it. Like these are rookie mistakes. It's just like watching The Mandalorian all over again.
Steal their armor like in A New Hope. That's what I was expecting.
That's totally what I was expecting. But if they do that, everyone's like, oh, JJ's copying A New Hope. Well, you can't. So he's damned if he does. He's damned if he doesn't. Like,
how come Rey can make those, what was it, two stormtroopers believe what she wants them to believe? Like, oh, we're happy to see you. Well, remember that scene?
Yeah.
How come she can't do that to all stormtroopers then? Just do the whole ship. You know?
Well, that's what I was wondering. So, like, instead of them shooting them, they could have just said, you know what? You're going to escort us to where we want to go.
Right.
and you're going to, you know, shoot anyone that tells us, that tries to stop us. That's what they should have done. Just take control of the stormtroopers. But whatever. They did what they did. They shot them, left them there so anybody could find out that there's something wrong right away with that ship. The stormtrooper mind trick was awesome, though. Yeah, that's fine. Welcome aboard. We're happy to see you. Would you like some wine? So then they split up. So Rey goes to find Chewie, and these two guys, Poe and Finn, go. Where do they go?
No, Rey goes off on her own, and Finn and Poe were off to find Chewie.
Okay.
Yeah. Rey went off, sensed something and wanted to go off, and she ended up in Kylo's quarters.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. No, I know she went on her own.
Because she was looking for the dagger.
Right. Okay. So she goes looking for the dagger. They go looking for Chewie, because it's always a good idea to split up when you're on the enemy territory.
And, absolutely.
But that scene with Poe and Finn running down the corridor. And again, they got those things where you can hide behind so you can shoot things. Every Star Wars ship has that, eh? You can hide behind the corners and shoot stuff. But I love that scene where they're running down the corridor and they're just shooting stormtroopers and they're falling in front of the camera. And the camera angle looks like it's on a mouse droid or something. Did you catch that shot?
I don't think I remember what you're talking about.
Favorite shot in the entire movie. It looks like you picture a camera mounted on a mouse droid, and the mouse droids, and they're chasing after it, shooting stormtroopers, and the stormtroopers are falling down, and they're jumping over the stormtroopers. But the camera angle was phenomenal. I just loved it. And that was like the Last Jedi. There was a shot when they're on the gambling planet when they first come in, and it's a one shot going forward over all the tables. That's my favorite shot in The Last Jedi. And this is my favorite scene in Rise of Skywalker.
Hey, let's back up real quick to scene after the quicksand when they're in that that underground.
With the
worm. And Rey heals the worm. Giant snake thing.
Yeah.
That, I mean, is it an obvious nod to Mandalorian?
Without going into spoilers, yes.
Well, are we past the spoiler part?
Well, the Mandalorian spoiler.
Oh, sorry.
You haven't seen Mandalorian yet. Yeah, they can use
Well, I think that was one of the reasons why they had Mandalorian come out on Wednesday to begin with instead of Friday.
Right.
Same day as the movie.
So they could have introduced that element.
The force healing.
And how did they get out? Did he just follow that worm out?
Well, once the worm moved, there was light behind it, like it was blocking the opening. I looked at that and went, okay, are we watching a video game at this point? Okay, heal the thing, and then the path to the next scene is open.
That's a great point. It really felt like a video game at times. In this, it's like, we have to get the knife. We lost the knife. We have to go here to get the knife. We have to go here. We have to go there. It was like these little choppy missions.
There are a lot of side missions in this movie.
Well, I think when she healed that snake, that snake realized they were no threat and kind of maybe either let that cave be exposed right there to get out. I think that's what I thought.
Mm-hmm. Okay, fair enough. Because I missed it both times I've seen the movie. I didn't understand how they got out. They just all of a sudden they were out. So the scenes with Kylo Ren and Rey doing their force projection Skype messaging. Skype.
Okay, I have questions about that because they had specifically said before that Snoke was the one that was connecting them, and now they seem to be connecting to each other on their own.
No, we're not going to worry about that part. don't look at that. Just look over here.
Never mind the man behind the curtain.
They can apparently start passing things back and forth, no matter how far apart they really are.
I thought
I have to think about that too deeply.
Yeah, I thought that was weird. How Kylo Ren was able to grab the necklace off of Rey and to see where she was at, and also wore the Darth Vader mask when they were fighting, got back
and
to
the berries and the lightsaber. Like they got really good at that. Yep. Like think of all the money they're going to save on UPS and whatnot. they could just, teleport, never mind drones.
And then they also made this big deal about the two of them being, what they call it, a diode in the force or whatever, the two as one or whatever, which I thought they were going to pay that off a little differently than they did. I really thought, kind of skipping ahead to the end a bit, I thought she was going to end up striking down Palpatine and absorbing all of the Sith and having all of the Jedi, but having to share it between her and Kylo together to totally bring balance to the Force. And that's not the direction they went, but I thought that would have been a more interesting direction than just now it's all Jedi and no Sith.
Well, yeah. So does that mean that the balance of the Force isn't balanced at all?
That's exactly the point. It's like, I thought they were going to balance the Force, and instead they went, no, the Jedi win over the Sith. And that seems the exact opposite of balance to me.
Yep. Yeah. And it was always supposed to be in that Anakin was the chosen one. He was going to bring balance to the Force. So Anakin kind of brought balance to the Force by destroying, but even when he supposedly destroyed Palpatine, again, it was only the Jedi left because Luke was left.
Right.
So that didn't bring balance to the Force either. So now we got Rey here.
And if he was supposed to have killed off all the Sith, he failed because Palpatine was here.
yeah. So that he never did. So that means Anakin never brought balance to the Force. He never. I don't know. Like, is balance you have good and evil, or is balance we only have good?
Well, that being said, though, with Rey having the Palpatine lineage, doesn't she have a little bit of Sith in her to begin with? And now she's a Jedi, so essentially there is balance. She's going to be fighting that conflict probably for the rest of her life. Or do you think she just totally overcame it and now she's a Jedi?
You know what? That's an excellent point. Plus, she now has the yellow lightsaber, which is no longer Sith nor Jedi. Maybe that is balance.
Yep.
Excellent point, Scott. Excellent point. Yeah, I think
I'm going to go with that one.
Yeah, we're doing that one for now. The four of us solved it.
We solved Star Wars. Yay.
We're kind of running out of time, but I did want to talk about Harrison Ford. That was a shock. I was not expecting to see Harrison Ford in this at all. You guys?
Yeah, I had no idea he was in this.
Yeah, they hit this pretty good. You didn't hear nothing about him making a cameo in this. And, you know, like I said, it is fan service, but I'm the fan, and I enjoyed seeing that.
So now, I heard a spoiler about a week ago that he was going to be in it. And I also heard, and I don't know if this is true, but the rumor was is that that whole scene was supposed to be Carrie Fisher.
That's what I was going to bring up.
And then they grabbed Harrison Ford after she passed, and he agreed to do it because she passed away.
That was exactly what I didn't hear that, but I had that feeling the entire time I was watching it that I bet you this was supposed to be Carrie Fisher's role, spot, mm-hmm. like part. And I kept thinking the entire time we're seeing it that this would be Carrie's doing this, but she can't.
That would have made so much more sense, actually.
Right.
Yeah.
I mean, just this memory, because we've never seen that sort of thing in Star Wars before, of just having this memory in front, talking to someone like that. Usually you only see that in a movie for a crazy person.
Well, and the other thing too, I'm not very good at judging whether a guy's handsome or not. But when I see Kylo Ren, Adam Driver, to me he doesn't look like a very handsome guy. And I see Carrie Fisher, who's gorgeous, and I see Harrison Ford, who's he's a darn right handsome guy. How did the two of them make Adam Driver? I don't get it. I see that no chin and the big nose and the scraggly hair, and I think those. I don't think that Harrison Ford was really the father of this. I think Princess Leia was. It's not a off-world doing something she shouldn't have been doing. I could be wrong. Anyways, then the big battle scene, and what do you think of that? The big battle scene at the end. We're going to talk about this.
Oh yeah, I think there was a big battle scene. I'm trying. No.
Before we go, what did you think about the spy? Finding out who the spy was.
I thought it was a good twist. I was just mad that they killed him so fast. Yeah,
that was another instance where it's like we got that reveal and then it ends up being so meaningless because they just undo it right away.
Yeah.
My immediate thought was that it was kind of like the one storyline from, I think, Rebels it was, where they had the one guy that they thought was against them turned out to be a spy.
I felt that was a J.J. Abrams versus Rian Johnson thing. I think it was like, okay, you're going to bring Krennic in. I don't like Krennic. I'm going to kill him off really easy and make him a spy. There, take that. Take that, Rian.
You know what I kept doing, Stan? I kept looking for the camera like I was on Star Tours, thinking that it was going to be one of us in the crowd.
You are the rebel.
I was like, please be me. Please be me.
Nice.
Dan sitting in the audience with his I'm the Rebel Spy t-shirt he bought at Hollywood Studios.
Got my sticker.
I did like his explanation, though. I don't care if you win. I just want him to lose.
Yeah, that was good.
That's all the explanation you need, right? Like,
and I did like Kylo coming in with the head of the creature that we saw earlier and just throwing it on the table.
Yeah, that was funny.
I thought that was a cool scene, too. There was a lot of like there's so much good scenes in this movie for sure. Are we gonna okay? Well, we get
the big battle, but before the battle, we also get that shot of all those ships coming in.
Yeah,
that was pretty nice.
I need a still frame of that. You know, a picture of that just to look at all those ships.
Yeah, my eyes were darting like crazy, trying to see something I would recognize, and I didn't see anything. How about you guys?
I think the ghost is supposed to be in there from Rebels.
Yep.
I couldn't find it at the, you know, watching it on the at the theater. I was looking.
There's just
for
too
it.
Many. There's just too many.
Way too many.
Yeah, like I was looking, like I was like, okay, the ghost has got to be in here. I thought maybe the Razor Crest from Mandalorian might have been there.
I think that's supposed to be in there, but yeah, I couldn't see it in the theater.
Yeah, no, I didn't recognize anything. They probably had the potato from the asteroid field in there for all we know. But yeah, and it was very reminiscent to, I guess, Return of the Jedi. I mean, Ryan, I mean, JJ does like to do the same beats. And again, yeah, it's fan service, but we're the fans. That's what we want. That's what we like. Do we want to go straight to the ending?
Yeah, go to the ending.
Okay. So we end up with Rey on... Oh, I like the Ewoks. I thought that was a cool little thing.
That was a nice little nod, especially since we'd been to Endor earlier.
Yeah. When Chewie finds out that Princess Leia, General Leia, dies, was he overacting? He was more upset about that than when Han died, it felt like.
Yeah, but I don't know. I think he needed that because I think that was like a tearjerker too. I know there was a couple people in my group that were like wiping their eyes a little bit in that scene.
He fell down to his knees and he's waving his arms around. Get away from me. I mean, I guess it was like, that was like the straw that broke the camel's back type of thing.
Yeah, right.
Like,
he's been through so much at this point.
Yeah.
That's like the last of the old school guys.
I think the thing too is like when Han died, he had a gun and people to shoot at. So he just expressed his grief in a different way that time.
Exactly. I agree with you, Justin. Yeah.
Yeah. But I mean, if you're a Wookiee and you're, what is he, 800 years old, 900 years old, he had to have a lot of friends die over the beers already. Like, that's just the way it is when you're a Wookiee.
Yeah.
You know, you're going to live longer than all your friends. Yeah. You know? So anyways, I thought that was kind of unusual. And then he got the medal from Maz.
From Maz.
Yeah. What did you guys think?
Just seemed to come out of nowhere. I wasn't, was just kind of like, yeah, that was so much of this just exists for fan service and for no other reason.
And you know what? And even the casual fan still doesn't get it. You know, I think you have to be a really big Star Wars fan to know what the gripe is that he, and for those listeners that don't know what the gripe is, that he didn't get a medal at the end of Jedi. Right.
I would have rather had her go, Chewie, this is for you. And she brings out like an iPad and it's a video of Han being the only one that shoots when Greedo and Han were in their canteen. That's what I would have rather seen.
And it would have made as much sense.
Yeah. Greedo never got a shot off, Chewie, just so you know. But anyways. So we get to Tatooine and we're back at the Skywalker homestead of Luke's Skywalker and his uncle and aunt. Looked pretty good.
I appreciated this bit of fan service. I thought I enjoyed seeing that set from the original movie again.
Yeah, and the sandcrawler from the Jawas they flew over. She didn't park too far. I appreciated that. She parked far away, but not too far. I thought the homestead looked pretty good, all things considered. You go to people who have gone to see the homestead now, like 40 years later, and it was in rough shape, and some fans raised money and they went back and fixed it. It's still standing. It's in the middle of the desert in Tatooine, or not Tatooine, in
Tatooine.
It's in Tatooine. If you just go to Tatooine.
Tatooine. bring sunblock though, it's hot.
There's two suns. It's very, very hot.
Where is it filmed? Come on, help me, guys.
I don't know. I don't even
know this. No, in the desert.
Tunisia or something like that?
Yeah, Tunisia. Yeah. You can still go there and it's still there. And it had crumbled down to next to nothing and some fans raised money and went and fixed it. So,
wow.
Yeah. So anyway, I thought it was great. I thought it was awesome. And
so what do you guys think about the last line?
Okay, that's what I want to get to. So she buries the two lightsabers. I got to comment on the last line, but I'll let you guys go first. So she says, what's your name? Ray who? Well, Ray Skywalker, after she sees Luke and Leia lying in front of her friends. what do you guys think of that ending, that line? Justin?
Well, first of all, it's a bit odd to even ask some stranger, well, what's your full name?
What's your real name?
And where did she come from? And that's the other thing I like to know. She just all of a sudden appeared out of nowhere. Middle of the desert. Anyways.
But yeah, I guess I wasn't clear on where that didn't, it felt like it came out of nowhere again, kind of like with the metal where it's like, I get it, but I don't get it.
So I have two theories here. Yeah. So I just don't think they did a good job with the story development, because I think they should have done a little bit more of Luke and Leia being the father and mother figure. And that probably should have been done in the last movie, to be honest, a little bit more. And I think that would have felt a little bit more right, that she's saying after she sees Luke and Leia. The other part that I was thinking, and this may be a far-fetched, but okay, so when Kylo dies, what exactly is happening there? Why did he die?
Well, he gave his life force to her.
Okay, so does she now possess his life force?
Yeah, but he's a Solo. But he's Ben Solo. He's not Ben Skywalker.
Well, he has Skywalker blood, though.
Okay.
Right?
No, I agree with that, Dan. You know, life force to bring back. So, that makes sense why she could call herself a Skywalker now.
Right. I mean, even though the last name isn't the same, he's a Solo. But she does have half Skywalker blood, right? I mean.
Well, then that being said, though, too, is with Rey, you know, from the in between The Last Jedi and The Rise of Skywalker, she was being trained by Leia to be Jedi, so that's kind of her mother figure, so to say.
Right.
I think Dan is right in that they really should have done a little better job in explaining it, but that does make sense if she was looking at to Luke as a father figure and looking to Leia as a mother figure, than to say, okay, you know, I am their daughter.
Yeah.
That kind of makes, that would have made it feel more like it makes sense.
And it's almost like you are not who you're born into, but who you choose to be, like that type of ideology, you know?
So what matters, what you're saying, what matters is not who you are, but what you choose to be.
Exactly.
Okay. This is my theory. I'm bringing it back to Earth. World War II happens. World War II ends. Hitler has a niece. Her name is Ray Hitler. Okay.
She's not going to go around with that name.
So, yeah, exactly. You're going to go around and tell people your name is Ray Hitler? You might not want to do that. You might want to change your name. And Palpatine was kind of like...
I honestly expected her... Just to pull off of that, I honestly expected her to say Ray Solo.
Yeah. Yeah, that's kind of what I was expecting her to say, actually. But yeah, if you're gonna, or if she said Ray Palpatine, like, ooh,
yeah, the lady runs away. Like,
yeah, exactly, because like Palpatine was like very well known throughout the universe.
Right.
Well, yeah, he was the Emperor. I mean, if anyone should be known in this universe, it should be him.
Yeah, and he was like a politician. You know, you see on Rebels or Clone Wars, whatever, he had the big screens of him screaming and stuff like that. You know, even on Episode 3, they had the big screens of Palpatine talking and stuff. So I think it was 3. Maybe it was Rebels I'm thinking of. But anyways, that's what I thought. I thought, well, I'm not going to admit that I'm a Hitler. I'm not going to admit that I'm a Palpatine. I'm going to come up with something else. I haven't had a last name my entire life, so know what difference does it make?
Mm-hmm.
That's my theory, but it does make sense. It doesn't make sense at all, my theory, but that does make sense about her having half of the Rey's or Ben Solo's life force.
Yeah.
Any final thoughts, guys?
I enjoyed it. You know, I went. I had a good time. I wasn't. You know, I told the story. I think when we reviewed The Last Jedi on this podcast, that I actually fell asleep in the movie theater. Like that's how much I did not like that movie. And I don't do that often in movies. But I love this movie. I really liked it a lot.
Actually, you know what, Dan, I remember that. And I also remember when we were reviewing Last Jedi, I looked at my watch like 3 or 4 times during the movie. Just wondering how much time was. I never do that at movies. Look at my watch to see how much longer we have to go. I did that Last Jedi a couple times. Didn't look at my watch. Didn't even think of looking at my watch in this one. How about you, Scott?
Really enjoy it. It's a feel-good Star Wars movie. If you're a Star Wars fan, you'll enjoy it, and go see it.
Justin?
Yeah, I have had a few quibbles with it over the course of this review, but overall I really enjoyed it, and it was a lot of fun, and it had just enough fan service, even if a couple of them were out of place. But yeah, I really enjoyed it overall.
So my local news said that they're going to announce the next three movies in January. I didn't hear that anywhere else. I don't know if they are or not, if they're going to wait to Celebration to announce what the next storylines are going to be, but where does Lucasfilm and Disney take Star Wars now? Is it going to be standalone movies? Is it going to be another trilogy? What do you want to see as fans? Right.
So I heard for a fact that Lucasfilm said they are not doing trilogies anymore. Like, that's not okay. happening.
That's, I kind of heard that too.
Yeah, so I would think that's true. The way I think it's going to go, I think they're going to go around, they're going to throw some things against the wall. They're going to see what sticks, like the Baby Yoda, you know? And then they go from there, you know, they make mm-hmm. more decisions to see what characters and what storylines the fans like.
So which storyline do you want to see as a fan? The rise of General Grievous.
Is this, the real question is this the end of Rey? Are we going to see more of Rey later on? Just not in this.
Since she's kind of now the last surviving Jedi, I think we're going to see something of her again.
I
would think it would be interesting if they would pick up from something from the end of The Last Jedi, which seemed to imply that the Force was awakening in other people outside of the Skywalker and Palpatine bloodlines. I would like to see some more of that, some of the other Jedis outside of these three bloodlines or whatever that we've been dealing with so far.
Yeah,
I would like to see him go in the direction of the Knights of the Old Republic, you know, way back when, you know.
Yeah, it doesn't interest me very much, that part, but I could see them doing that too. A lot of fans do like that. I'd like to see what them carry on with, they teased in Solo with Darth Maul, what he's been up to.
Yeah, I wouldn't mind seeing a Solo too. I think, you know, that would be good. You know, kind of intertwine Solo into Obi-Wan, right into there.
I really don't see them doing a Solo 2, but I could see them doing a Maul.
Well, aren't they doing the Darth Maul series? Didn't they announce that for Disney Plus?
Maybe.
I thought they did. Maybe
I'm wrong, I know there's an Obi-Wan one.
Hold on, let me just double check.
I think they announced that I'm getting a series on Disney Plus. That seems like every they've done so many announcements, official and unofficial, of stuff that's coming to Disney Plus. It's hard to keep track anymore. What's real, what's not.
Let's see. Yeah, it's in development right now. Darth Maul TV series for Disney Plus.
Oh, well, there you go. Okay, so it won't be a movie then.
Yeah.
I'm interested to see what's next. I'm sure everyone listening to this is interested to see what's going to be next. Time will tell. It'd be interesting to find out what happens. And with that, take it away, Ken.
If you would like to keep the adventure going after the show, be sure to like our Facebook friends page, Grand Circle Tour Magical Ticket Holders. While on Facebook, like our group page, Grand Circle Tour. Be sure to follow us on Twitter, Grand Circle Tour Podcast, as well as Instagram, GCT Podcast, and our YouTube channel, Grand Circle Tour. If you would like to send us a message, you can email us at gctpodcast@gmail.com. T-shirts and other fun merchandise can be found at tpublic.com. Simply search Grand Circle Tour Podcast. If you enjoyed your adventure, leave us a review on Apple Podcast. Only one rule, make it good. Thank you for riding with us, and welcome home.